morning. Let's begin with our call to worship. Hymn number 621, Lead On, O King Eternal. And we'll do the first and third verses. Praise this morning is hymn 455, I Must Tell Jesus. Let's do the first and third verses. I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distress, He kindly will help me. He ever loves and cares for His own. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me, Jesus alone. Tempted and tried, I need a great Savior, one who can help my burdens to bear. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus. He all my cares and sorrows will share. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, Jesus can help me, Jesus
alone. Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. What a privilege it is to be together on this first Sunday of June. And so the first Sunday is our Lord's Supper Sunday. So if you will, take a few moments and prepare your elements that we can participate in the Lord's Supper in just a few moments at the end of the service. Just by way of announcements, let me encourage you to continue to pray for the COVID-19 virus and the new guidelines that the state are opening up for phase two, but it's still pretty much of a hindrance on worship services. But our deacons will be meeting, and we'll be getting back to you very soon on what we think's safest for our church family. Also, with the riots that are going on and the protesting, we are saddened by the conduct that we're seeing on TV. And also, I wanted to let you know that from all the food that you have been sending through the month of May, the Emergency Management Office that requested that has also sent out notification to us of the three protest events that will be taking place here in our county beginning Friday and then two on Sunday. So if you would, please be aware of that in the courthouse area. Let's take a few moments now and let's pray together. Father, again, we just pray that you give us strength for this day, strength for the decisions that we need to be making to glorify Jesus. I pray that we will be strong and that when temptations come our way that we have been studying through our scripture times, that you will just lift us up. Father, you know that there are struggles and that there are confusions and uncertainties, but you are with us in all circumstances. I humbly ask that you bring your Holy Spirit into the lives of people who have moved outside of protesting due to the death of George Floyd to now rioting. Rioting does not deliver us from injustices. Rioting causes divisions. Holy Spirit, you guide us and you teach us how we are to conduct ourselves. The Holy Word of God tells us in Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, that we all are made in the image of God. May we conduct ourselves in respect of that image. All people are equal because Jesus died on the cross and rose from the grave to save all people. Holy Spirit, through faith in Jesus Christ, carry us when we are too weak. When we stumble into temptation, forgive us. And Heavenly Father, we need your strength to overcome the evils that are all around us. Through faith in Jesus Christ, we will triumph against evil. Therefore, we praise you, Father. For without you, we will not be able to stand nor be able to put on the full armor of Jesus Christ. You are our strength. You are our protection. You are worthy of all praise and honor. It's through the very strong name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Donna's going to come and lead us in a special music now.
Now that I have the answer.
right there all the time. He was there all the time. He was there all the time, waiting patiently.
Thank you, Donna. That was beautiful. Thank you. Well, let's take our Bibles again, if we will, and turn to our parallel scripture reading. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 and 24. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. And when the Bible talks about the heart, it's talking about our soul, our very being, what makes us up. So keep our soul with all diligence, for out of it come the issues of life. Put away from thee a forward mouth and perverse lips. Put far from thee.
Our hymn of invitation today is hymn 446, Take Time to Be Holy, and let's do verses 1 and 4.
Father, as we come now this morning to our offertory prayer, we thank you that you fill every need that we have. Your word says that we live to honor you and that we bring the first fruits of our wealth to you because they're our best, but also that shows that we depend on you to give us the next fruits. I humbly ask that you accept our tithes and offerings as a gift of our worship to you. May they be used to multiply your life-giving growth in your kingdom. I pray for Jesus to dwell in our hearts through faith so that we will be rooted and that we can help others to be rooted and grow in Jesus Christ. We pray now in his very strong name. Amen. Thank you. Let's take our Bibles once again, if you will, and let's turn to Ephesians chapter 6. And as we've said, when you worship with Gloucester Point, you need to have your Bibles. The Lord's Word is our direction and our guidance as we serve Him. You know, in the first century, the Apostle Paul lived and many people, especially the Jewish people, believed that demons were rampant, that you could even have a demon and dwell in your body through eating and drinking. They could enter your body, and during that first century, skulls have been discovered that have holes in their head. They believed that in order to get rid of some of those demons, you needed to have a hole in your head. I hate to be that person that had to have the demon removed. I really would. Well, today is our last sermon in our series on who will protect us. And through our series, we have learned that tens of millions of angels are worshiping around the throne of God at all times. We've learned that a believer does not have one angel, but has multitudes of angels that God sends to protect us, that are at His beckoning call to help us in our times of need. We've seen that the highest cherub, that's the singular form of cherubim, the highest cherub became the fallen angel whose light led millions of angels to defect and to rebel against God and to leave heaven and join Satan, to join Lucifer. We read where Satan's proud intelligence and his corrupt beauty was used to deceive people. We learned that our safety is in Christ Jesus. Satan cannot have the soul of a believer. He cannot inhabit the believer. Good and evil can't occupy the same place. Our bodies as a believer is the sanctuary of God. However, we have learned that Satan has schemes and he has snares which he uses his demons to tempt us, to try to get at us, to distract us, and to discredit us. They cannot have our souls, but they can't have our testimony. They can't have our effectiveness. So what are we to do? Are we just sitting ducks? Well, that's where Paul's going to help us tonight as we come to our final sermon in our series. Tonight we're going to be thinking about getting all dressed up with the armor of God and kneeling down to pray. Let's take our Bibles and turn to Ephesians chapter 6. Let's pick back up at verse 14 where we left off our last time together. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 14 through 17. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about you with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, take the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Now, we've seen on TV the riots that are taking place, and we want to pray for those people. We want to pray for the families of the police officers, but also the family of George Floyd. This has been a very difficult week for us. I personally believe that Satan has been on the rampage and he's planning all these evil thoughts into everyone's head. But there was some good news this week. Did you see this past Saturday, the launch of the astronauts returning to space? Did you notice the suits that they were wearing? I've heard those space suits now that they wear are tuxedos. compared to what the other astronauts had to wear. The spaceship themselves, the rocket, the Falcon rocket, after it blasted off and took them into suborbit, returned back to Earth and landed on the deck of a Navy ship to be reused again. Man, that makes the old Saturn V rocket look obsolete. But think about this. The Bible tells believers to dress as Christian warriors. I'm not sure that "Onward Christian Soldiers" is the hymn that we need to sing, but look at verse 14. Notice what the Bible says. It says to strap on the belt of truth. The Christian, meaning the Christian, submits. Believers submit and look to the authority of the Scriptures. The Scriptures alone determine the truth. The Scriptures alone dictate our lifestyle, not government officials, not church fathers or church committees or church customs, but the Word of God. To strap on the truth for life is in the Bible. The reformer Martin Luther, some 450 plus years ago, made this quote: "The Bible is like a lion. You don't need to defend it. You just need to let it loose." And I thought how appropriate that is, that the Christian holds the Scriptures. Believers are vulnerable to deceit and to the doctrines of the demons, to his snares, but we are not defeated. Because look again at verse 14. When we strap on the Word, then we have the breastplate of righteousness. So let's talk a little bit about history. I love studying this. The Roman soldiers, way back in the biblical times, they wore breastplates. Most of them were made from thick linen draped over their chest. And some had bone fragments in it. It was heavy. It was fairly weighted down. It was to protect their heart, basically, and other vital organs. But now, if you were wealthy and an officer, you had a metal plate made out of bronze that went from the base of your neck down to your lap. It offered a little more protection. Well, what the Bible is saying for you and me today, that a believer's heart, we're covered in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Our hearts, though deceitful, though wicked, have been covered. We are covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. It's not what we do. It's what he has already done. Jesus Christ covers us. That's what Solomon was trying to say to us, and I think he said it excellent in our parallel scripture in Proverbs 4:23. He says to watch out over your heart, your soul, with all diligence, on purpose. You've got to pay attention. For from it springs of life. How we conduct ourselves in public, how we conduct ourselves in private, is determined from our heart, from our inner soul. And we need to be filled with this armor of Jesus Christ, the belt of truth and the breastplate of righteousness. This breastplate of righteousness that covers our vital organs really is saying that we're going to live for God's approval. So let's ask ourselves, whose approval are we living for? How do we defend ourselves in this spiritual warfare? By holy living, shunning evil. Also, I think refusing to justify and to explain away our actions that are not glorifying to God. Solomon is teaching us to commit to living a life that honors God in holiness. And then Paul moves us on now into verse 15. Your feet, the shoes here in verse 15, being ready to spread the gospel, ready to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. And the good news of Jesus Christ is don't do this and don't do that. The good news of Jesus Christ is, I love you. Come. Come and be in my family. And I think that's what a lot of people are looking for in our society today. I think that's why we have gangs in our society today. People want to belong. People want to be a part of something that loves them. That's why we come to church, because we love being together and belonging to a body. Beloved, if you do not belong, you feel on the outside and you're searching, don't go looking sideways to other people, but let us look up to Jesus Christ. For he has given us the shoes to spread the good news. Now, in Paul's day, these Roman soldiers wore leather shoes, and on the bottom of those shoes, they had somehow pressed in shards of metal that would give them like a cleat to give them a stronger footing, a balanced footing, so that when they attacked up a hill, they could keep their footing, or when they were on slippery terrain, they could maintain their footing. It was harder to knock over a Roman soldier than it was someone else who was wearing sandals. For the believer, our gospel shoes for spreading the word, it's imperative that we wear them and to fight Satan. And we don't have to fight Satan by being mean and hateful and vindictive. The best way to fight Satan is to say, come to Jesus. He died for you. He's reaching out for you. Come to him. Verse 16, the shield of faith. You see that in verse 16? Now, to me, this is probably one of the most fascinating pieces of armor that the Romans used in battle. They had two types of shields, and they were used for different methods. The first shield was a smaller shield that they would wear on their arm that they would use in combat to where they could deflect us or hit the enemy in their head with that shield. It was just like another club that they used. The other shield was a big piece. It was about 4 feet in diameter and about 2 feet wide. And the shield protected the soldier. A lot of times, if you would allow me to use our good old Baptist hymnal, that the soldier would use his shield, and so many times the enemy's arrows would be coming at such an onslaught that he would just bury that shield in the ground and get behind it and just wait it till the arrows stopped. The same way it is for a believer's life. Satan's temptations at us, and we are weak at times, but we know that we have the shield of faith. We have God's promises. We have God's providence with us. And so another reason, another way that they used the shield, that they would line up in lines across the battlefield. And the Romans, the shield was beveled on the edge. So you could hope this works for us. I practice, so hope it'll work tonight and help us. That the shields would overlap and lock together so that you'd have one long shield of protection. But what's interesting about the Romans, they also took their shields. That was the front row, but the second row would be exposed. So the second row of soldiers would take his shield and place it on the top of the front one. And therefore, they were protected, the one in the front and the one under their shields. Beloved, Jesus Christ has covered us. We are protected by his shield of grace and mercy and his strength, that you and I will be able to stand and be protected, and we will know that we will not be forgotten and we will not be defeated. Now, another interesting part about that Roman shield, perhaps if you could see this brass writing, there was also being a brass knob on their shield. And those soldiers would sit around and they would polish that brass knob up and just get it as shiny as they could so that when they went out on the battlefield, they would make sure they would try to catch the sun and reflect the sun into the enemy's eyes to hinder them, to stop them for a moment. Well, guess what? As a believer in Jesus Christ, you and I reflect the Word of God. You and I are a reflection of Jesus Christ. This shield of faith, we can use it to extinguish the fiery darts that Satan shoots at us, and that we can share others to come and see the light, one who is light, Jesus Christ. Now look at verse 17. The helmet of salvation. Now, this morning, we would kind of wonder, what in the world would we do with a helmet? Well, the soldiers used a helmet for multiple reasons. At times, they would lay the helmet down on the dirt and lay their head on it for a really hard pillow. Other times, the helmet was turned upside down, and it was used for placing water for drinking, and it's also for bathing out of the helmet. Aren't we glad for showers and baths today? But most importantly, the helmet was placed onto the head to protect the mind, to protect the thoughts. And that's where Satan comes at you and me in our head, and he places doubts in our minds about Jesus Christ and about our salvation really being real and true. And that's why the Bible says, put on the truth. Put on the helmet of salvation to protect our minds from Satan attacking us. Also in verse 17, it's the sword of the Spirit. This is the only offensive weapon. All the other weapons were defensive to help us, to protect us. The sword is an offensive, going on the charge weapon. When Jesus went into the wilderness to be tempted on those three times, he didn't go out into the wilderness to say, let me bind up the spirit and let me cast down the devil. No, he told the devil this, it is written. Jesus Christ used the Bible. He used the Bible as a sword of the Spirit. When you and I encounter Satan, when you and I encounter the temptations that are in our world today, I want you to be using the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. Now, you and I know that the Roman soldiers had sharpened their swords on both edges so that when they were lined up behind their shield and moving forward, they could take their sword and stick it between the two shields. They could attack the enemy and still be protected. Well, we're tempted by Satan, I want you to know that you can still trust in the sword of the Word of God. It will not fail you. It will not let you down. It will give you victory over Satan. So now we're all dressed up and we've got our armor all on us and we are ready to go forward and to go. What does the Bible say that we do? Paul tells us there in verse 18. Let's read 18 through 20 now to see what we do with all of our armor. Pray always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. So imagine a soldier getting all dressed up with his armor, but instead of going out, he kneels down to pray. We are getting all dressed up to kneel down to pray. Beloved, that's what's going to get us through COVID-19. That's what's going to get us through the rioting. That's what's going to help our law enforcement officials and all of our medical people is the prayers that we lift up on behalf of them. Beloved, no Christian is exempt from danger. Temptation is the enemy of every one of us. And it is possible for us to face Satan and for us to stand up against him by putting on, never taking it off, but putting on the armor with prayer. Gary Richman tells this fascinating story. He tells a story of a young zookeeper named Julie. He worked with the zoo at times and many different animals. The zoo had purchased a baby raccoon and it was one of Julie's duties to take care of that raccoon. Well, it wasn't long before Julie kind of fell in love with that little baby raccoon and up on her shoulders as she went about the zoo doing all of her duties. And Gary Richman kept telling her, said, I wouldn't do that. Said, at age 24 months, raccoons go through a glandular change. And without warning, they turn on their owners or they turn on their keepers. And Gary Richman said, I can always remember Julie's response. Well, It'll be different for me. Bandit wouldn't hurt me. He just wouldn't. Richmond wrote 3 months after my last warning to Julie. She had to have plastic surgery to repair her face, where Bandit had unprovokingly attacked her, being his normal self. The zoo turned Bandit loose into the wild. Here's what I want us to know. Sin comes at us, oh, all disguised and so puffy and beautiful looking, and we would say, this won't hurt me. It just wouldn't hurt me. Beloved, have you been hurt? Are you hurting? I want you to know the Word of God says, come to Jesus, and He'll heal you all of our scars by the stripes that He has received. Come to Jesus. Let's pray together. Holy Spirit, help us to be reminded that the Lord's Prayer includes the words, deliver us from evil. In essence, what we're praying is, Lord, I'm admitting that I can't take care of myself. Please protect us from the tempter. We're going to fight temptations every day. So let us get dressed in the armor and kneel down to pray. Maybe the first prayer you need to pray is that of the sinner's prayer. Dear God, I admit that I have sinned against you. I admit that I have never believed in Jesus as my Savior and Lord. I repent of that sin. I believe this very moment that Jesus Christ is my answer. He is my Savior. He came to earth. He died on the cross. He bore my sin. He was buried in the tomb and rose the third day and ascended back into heaven. And I believe that now with all of my heart. I don't understand it all, but I believe it, that He saves me. I commit my life to Jesus right now. I'm going to serve Jesus, not myself, but Jesus. Maybe you've already prayed that prayer some time ago and you've been a Christian for a while, but this morning you need to renew and prepare for your life to be putting on that whole armor of God, not just a piece every now and then or when it gets tough, but every day we put on the whole armor. Because Satan is powerful, and we can defeat him. You want to rededicate yourself to being a whole armor bearer for Jesus. And if you're looking for a church home, you're moving into this area, I want you to pray and call us, and we'll talk some more together about being a part of our church family here at Gloucester Point, where we want to serve Jesus. It's in the very strong name of Jesus we now pray. Amen.
Our hymn of invitation is hymn 447, Trust and Obey.
You have your elements ready. Those that are here with us this morning are coming to receive their elements. Whether you have coffee and a piece of toast or bread and tea or some juice, that will be just fine. And again, I ask you if you have your Bibles to turn with me as we prepare from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Begin reading in verse 23, you see where Paul was given this Lord's Supper to take the bread, for that's the body, and to break it and to bless it. And then to take the cup and to drink all of this in remembrance of Jesus. Then you come to verse 27. Paul says, "Wherefore whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthy shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord." But, always a good but, here's a way out. But, let a person, a man, examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. So right now, I'm asking you to examine yourself. Ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins so that you will be a pure guest invited to his table. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, again, we just thank you and pray that our sins are forgiven. They're washed clean by the blood, that our bodies are healed and whole from our brokenness of sin, has washed us white as snow. May we be forgiven and ask for the power not to commit these same sins again. In his name we pray, amen. If you have the elements, if you will, please take your bread now. And let us do this in remembrance of the love of Jesus. Paul says Jesus said to take the cup. And Paul has written for us that we do this in remembrance of him, that we are washed and that we are clean by the blood of Jesus, in remembrance of our Lord and Savior. I'd like to just invite you to join us next week. We'll begin a new sermon series on God's amazing grace and his restoring hope. We're going to look at a nation that didn't deserve his grace, probably deserved his judgment. The prophet that delivered hope to these people and along the way found hope for his own soul. Come back and join us next Sunday as we begin a little series on the prophet Jonah. Let's pray together. Father, again, I thank you for this moment and the honor that you've given to us again. What a joy it is to be worshiping together in our homes and wherever we are, as far as this message goes forth, may it unite us in our love of Jesus to know that we can kneel down to win. In the very loving name of Jesus, we pray, amen.
And our hymn of fellowship is hymn 387, "Blessed Be the Tie."